So why don't we start with a broad question about what areas you personally or your firms are excited about investing in over the next few years. Peter, why don't we start with you?
Sure. Well, good morning. Great to be here with all of you and the GSV team. Peter Bell. We're excited about a lot of that was a great video, but some of those areas. The autonomous vehicle space is one we're particularly excited about. We've recently invested in a company called Nutonomy. We announced a few weeks ago the first publicly available robotic taxi service. They're doing it's sort of a beta launch in Singapore, but a really compelling team. We met, they were doing research at MIT and really had developed really the kind of the sensor capability and a business model to partner with the auto manufacturers. So we thought it was a compelling team and a really exciting business model. So I think that's one of the areas. You know, many of us obviously in this room use Lyft and other types of services. As you know, the expense is obviously the labor. And if you look at safety, what you can do now with sensor technology and off-the-shelf, computing components, it's really quite amazing. So, one of the largest markets in the world, a global opportunity. And real technology. Obviously, it's a very competitive space, a lot going on here, going on in Pittsburgh, going on all over the world, but we think it's one of the most exciting areas, and it leverages some of the other investments we've done over the years in robotics. So we can maybe talk more about that as well.
Great. And Sandy, how about you?
Sure. Well, there's so much that's exciting. You saw some of it in that video. And our focus actually at IVP is on later stage technology investing, so we're not really looking at startups, but we're still looking, of course, at the big trends in the future. I'll just mention two things. One is we've had a great success record and been privileged to be involved with a number of really significant social gaming companies, Zynga, Supercell, NG Moco, and so we're always looking for the next wave in the gaming area, and that's pretty clearly going to be in virtual and augmented reality. So there's not, truthfully, from our perspective, a lot of companies to invest in literally right now for us, but that's going to change and maybe fairly rapidly. So we're really monitoring carefully what's happening there. And the reason why social gaming is so interesting as a vehicle for virtual and augmented reality is the proliferation of smartphones, obviously, is obvious. But it's amazing that the use of smartphones is concentrating more and more in gaming than ever before. So this is one of the largest markets in the world, clearly, and it's ripe for new change because the games that have been out for a while haven't really changed that much in the last several years. So I think the next, there'll be a quantum step up, and it's going to be driven by virtual augmented reality. I think that's exciting. We'll see some game companies built that are probably even bigger than the games companies we've seen to date, which are generating billions of dollars in profits, of course. The second area I'd mention is the whole financial technology area. Because the beauty of that is it's all digital. A lot of things, even wonderful companies are talking about, in transportation and so on, there's a lot of logistics involved with dealing with kind of things in the real world. The beauty of the financial technology is it's purely all digital. We've done a lot in alternative lending companies, but there's in payments companies. There's just a lot of new ideas being developed. That one's already ripe for investment now, and we're seeing still a wealth of great new ideas in investing in financial technology.
So Polaris is we manage about $4 billion. We're pretty evenly split between healthcare and technology. On the healthcare side, we're doing really innovative things. My partner, Kevin Bitterman, helped incubate a company out of MIT and Harvard called Editas. And it's built around CRISPR, which is gene editing technology. And companies like that can be platforms. It's not just a drug, but it's a platform that pharmaceuticals then can build on top of. So we really like these, very, very innovative, forward-looking, DNA technologies like CRISPR on the healthcare side. I'm on the tech side. There, we primarily focus on B2B SaaS. And what we like there are, things like the future of work and how the world of work is changing. And so anything that touches how we will do work in the future, and that can be from from hiring and recruiting and retaining and managing employees to different ways of actually doing the work itself. And then we also like companies where there's an element of data. So we're mostly B2B SaaS. Companies like Inside Sales are interesting because they help make sales reps, they help improve the frequency of a sales rep, make more dials. They also help improve the competency of a sales rep, know who to call. But the beauty of that business is there's an element of data where with every phone call, you're getting more and more data, which that in turn makes the system smarter and makes the sales rep smarter. So we like it where there's an element of data at scale, where that data can become a moat or a barrier to entry to other businesses.
Great. Sandy, I want to drill down on something that you mentioned. Mm-hmm. You know, you talked about VR and the commercial application
right.
of that potentially being a few years out. I think it was Peter Thiel who said, we're promised flying cars and we got 140 characters.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, how do you think about, and this question goes for all of you, how do you guys think about investing in ideas that, you know, whether they're kind of called moonshot ideas or just technologies where commercialization is potentially, you know, 3, 4, 5 years out?
Yeah, I think most big new technology ideas are overestimated in the short term and underestimated in the long term. So I think I think there's good reason to be excited about these things. Because of our later stage profile, you know, we don't invest in moonshots at the inception, but we try to pick up on them halfway to the moon and hopefully get them up to Mars rather than the moon. That's sort of the analogy. But the if you want to get big returns, you've got to look for big ideas.
Yeah, I think the challenge on, because we have a couple investments, I agree with Sandy's thesis on the AR, VR space and how it, gaming, and we also have a company called Jaunt. It's in what we call cinematic virtual reality, but it's sort of everything but gaming. So, experience what it would be like to sit courtside at a Warriors game if you don't want to spend, $3,000 a ticket, or go, walk the Golden Gate Bridge if you've never had the good fortune to go to San Francisco. So it's really a different immersive experience, almost sort of real time. Rendering, but it is very challenging in these what look to be moonshots as an earlier stage investor where we play on the timing. Mm-hmm. You want to arrive at the party just on time, not too early. You know, for us as an early stage investor, not too late, and then work with entrepreneurs who kind of post the capital raise, spend the money in the right way. When to really turn on kind of put your foot on the gas is very difficult because you raise the money, especially I'm just thinking about the VR and AR space. We've got another company called Leap Motion, which is really kind of around gesture recognition. Two young, incredible entrepreneurs, but we were a little bit early there, but they've done a good job sort of conserving cash, and now it looks to be a better time because of the partnerships they're doing with the headset manufacturers. But it's very difficult in these moonshots to sort of time the decision right and then to sort of deploy capital in the right way. But there are so many exciting things happening. And I think that video captured it. From a time for innovation, I think we're all fortunate to be here in Silicon Valley and working with great universities who are developing, the young people who've got the dreams to go to Mars.
You know, it's so hard. We were talking about it earlier. I met Brian Chesky early on, Airbnb, mm-hmm. and I thought that was a stupid idea. Like, I didn't want to sleep on anybody's couch, what I mean? And I don't know, Marriott's fine for me. What are you talking about? And there's HomeAway and VRBO, and sometimes it's just like, geez, how did I miss that? How did you not see it? But it's really hard when you're an early stage investor. Yesterday, I was a judge on the TechCrunch Disrupt panel. And there were some phenomenal presentations and great companies. And at the end, we were debating about which company was the best. And we kind of settled on the one that had the biggest market, even though their solution wasn't great. It was like, well, that's the one that has a shot at a moonshot because the market's big enough. So it's got to be a big market where they're solving a need. And it's got to be there's got to be complexity in there. Mm-hmm. Like you think about Uber and navigating the complexity of taxi and the like. But it's hard.
Yeah. And how do you evaluate, sometimes we'll meet with founders and there's the vision that they have for what their company can become, and then there's what the product is today or what the progress is today. How do you weigh those two things when you evaluate investments?
Well, one of my companies didn't make it, and the reason we didn't make it was because we were too broad. We had this vision, and we tried to execute on that vision, and it was just unrealistic. And so I got a first-class education in focus. Mm-hmm. And so when I was running Odesk, we focused in on the market where we were solving the biggest pain. And we said, once we tackle that market, then we can go to adjacencies. So I actually appreciate somebody that can explain their business and sort of act one, act two, act three. They say, look, act three, this is where we're going. But act one is where we are today. And act one isn't going to be big enough to create a $1 billion business, but we think act two and act three are. And so I actually like the disciplined approach of this is what we're doing today and this is what we'll do tomorrow.
Yeah, sometimes it's challenging because you want the entrepreneur, you want to back the entrepreneur in the early stages with the bold vision, but with the right judgment. And I was just thinking about your firm, Greylock, because I had the good fortune on my first company in the 90s to meet Dave Strom at Greylock. Fortunate enough, he gave me a term sheet, which I gladly accepted. But I remember the first lunch after the pitch, and he said, I had a bold vision. This is early in cloud computing. And he said, are you going to hire a CFO? I said, oh, yeah, down the road. He said, we'd kind of recommend doing that earlier, and it was some of the best advice. I think maybe I had the bold vision, but working with someone like Dave and a good partner sort of helps maybe refine that a little bit. So it's usually a team effort in all these endeavors.
And Sandy, how does that change when you think about later stage companies?
Yeah, we really think we're backing a team. Mm-hmm. So we really want to see the team in place that really is going to take it to that next level. So mm-hmm. I think I know at the earlier stage, you do face things where you're backing a CEO that you know is going to need to be enhanced later on. We kind of come in where we already see that. But you still get into the issue that Gary's talking about of the focus, because when we say late stage, these aren't public companies, not fully mature companies. They're still growth young companies. A lot of companies do get distracted. It seems, their core business looking a little tough, so let's look for how about this instead of looking for pulling a rabbit out of the hat rather than making the core thing work. So I think the focus still plays there, but we're looking for where there's already a good synergy between vision and the team.
Yeah. My good friend Reed Hastings gave me this advice when I was running Odesk. He said 90% of CEOs are under-focused and 10% are over-focused, and neither is good. And then he asked me, which one are you? And clearly the answer was under-focus. But as I was pitching him on one of these adjacencies that I thought we should go after, that was a great piece of advice.
Thinking about several of the areas you mentioned, autonomy, virtual reality, CRISPR, some of these are still in the early stages, not just of commercialization, but also in terms of the underlying science or technology. How do you all at your firms think about investing in kind of science projects versus technology that's ready for commercialization?
Good question. And sometimes we think it's ready for commercialization, it's still a science project. But we try to stay out of the science projects. So we're coming in, I think now with all the capital available through seed firms or through AngelList or other types of crowdfunding or here, in the Bay Area, New York, Boston, there's really robust set of knowledgeable angel investors. So, today the Series A often looks like what might have been a Series B, even 4 or 5 years ago. So we try to stay out of the science projects. We like to see things that we think within, 12 to 18 months, could be generating early revenues. That was our big debate in the autonomous vehicle space. Is it still a science project or is it really closer to be ready for prime time? The fact that they had a partnership with a major auto manufacturer, got us comfortable. But sometimes we're 2 or 3 years into it and still happens to be the science project. And it's difficult today with the, while there's plenty of capital, the Series Bs can be very challenging right now because Sandy and his firm are coming in, it's already working. So sometimes you have this where it's not yet working and you're going to need another good slug of capital and more time, and that's a very difficult, because then it's often an inside round, and because you can't attract the growth stage investor.
It's easy to say at late stage we don't invest in science projects, but we're always investing in technology because it's not a rare company. It's a complete null set where their current technology is going to be adequate for long-term future success. So even the more, you know, more established companies that have got a good thing going and they're on a rapid growth trend, they appear to be a technology leader, I mean, we've really got to assess what's behind that, what's really going to, you know, what's going to happen in the next generation, because it's going to be somebody smarter coming along with a new idea, and we've got to be able to be either out in front of that or at least be able to react and exceed that. So I think we're still evaluating the technology even at a later stage.
On the healthcare side, we invest in science projects. I mean, that's what you do. It's early, you know, we invested in CRISPR before it was even CRISPR, right? I mean, you're incubating these things from scratch. On the tech side, less so. Mm-hmm. On the tech side, I agree with Peter. We're kind of looking for, you know, some semblance of product market fit. And that could be an ARR number, an MRR number that you're comfortable with. But it's evidence that there's a market out there, there's a market that's in pain, and they're willing to pay to make that pain go away. And they don't have to have the repeatable use case nailed, but you want to see enough evidence that people will buy this thing, right? And then you've got to believe that it's a big enough market to create a big opportunity. And if you think about our diversified strategy, you know, you can think of the later stage or de-risked or product market fit evidence as the plane that's going to get you down the runway, but that doesn't do you any good unless you have some wings to take off, and the science projects can be the wings. Mm-hmm. And the wings don't do you, you know, larger wings aren't going to help you take off if you don't have the engine to get down the runway.
Right. So. But I just think, you know, it's not, you know, we talk about the moonshots. I mean, I think there's some, you know, great businesses that are very innovative, but it's not necessarily the science. Airbnb, good example. You know, we've got a company called Malwarebytes, which is one of our best performing companies. You know, the entrepreneur, he started his company at 14. And it was really, he sort of thought about, you know, how to, you know, basically get rid of malware in a much more innovative way that was much simpler for the user. And, you know, today he's got several hundred employees here in San Jose. And, you know, it's really now becoming a commercial product for enterprise computing. But it started from the ground up. It was really a different business model applied to endpoint security. So there's, I think, you know, innovation happens with things like, you know, autonomous vehicles. You know, it's going to happen in AR, VR, but there's a lot of other innovation happening here in the Valley and other parts of the world on, you know, very innovative, you know, on business models that have really large market opportunities.
I agree. Just to reinforce, that's a really valuable point. It's not only innovation of some new technology or science, but of the business model itself. That's a great point.
So given that venture investors are kind of more, lean more towards investing in business model innovation than when the science is a few years off from commercialization. You know, how should founders who are starting something that is kind of deeper science or, you know, is a more capital intensive project, how should they think about starting that business and fundraising for that business?
I think in those types of businesses, you really need to get, in the early phases, mm-hmm. investors that truly understand what you're doing, mm-hmm. you know, because there has to be an appreciation for the some of the challenges and the nuances, and perhaps someone who's maybe not in the same space, but done something similar, invested, or perhaps were an entrepreneur in a highly technical field, because they can help guide you and help with the mileposts along the way. And it will be more thoughtful around fundraising. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, many of these, and we have, you know, I think probably any venture capitalist who's doing early stage has these companies where they've got, you know, they've run out of runway, yet it's going actually okay. It's meeting the goals in terms of product development, but commercialization may be pushed out. And I think if you have a knowledgeable investor, and that could be a venture firm, that could be angel investors or a combination. You know, I think it's particularly critical in those businesses where, you know, not everyone's going to understand it. Because once these, you know, a company starts to take off, it's pretty easy, right. Easier to understand. You can look at comparables and things like that. You have at least a better view of what the exit might look like. It's pretty difficult in some of these spaces in the very early years.
I think strategic investors can play a role as well. Mm-hmm. They come with sometimes with baggage, but you know they could be people that have a deeper capital pockets, longer time frames, and an interest in a particular space could be relevant for that kind of situation as well.
And how do you guys think about building expertise in a certain area or investing in areas that are outside of your core expertise? So for example, you know, autonomy. 5 years ago, probably very few people in the venture industry could claim to really have expertise there. I know Greylock today is worth spending a lot of time in that space. So I guess, you know, things, new areas emerge, and how do you think about kind of sticking to what you know versus following those new areas that are emerging?
Well, hire really smart young people. That's how we found that. And we actually put a team just on that sector. And then partnering with people who have a lot of experience. So in this case, Bill Ford's firm is a co-investor. So we figured that was as good as you could get in terms of a co-investor knowledge about the auto space and very seasoned. So a combination of a lot of young expertise, and then leveraging your outside network. Stanford has a very strong program in autonomous vehicles. So spent a lot of time with some of the faculty at Stanford during our due diligence. And then Singapore, believe it or not, is sort of saying we're going to become, you know, the launch, kind of the launch pad, if you will, for autonomous vehicles. So there was a lot of help we got, both in terms of the diligence side of the space, but also as we, you know, made the investment and began to launch the company.
I think, you know, what I'm hearing here is just sort of a lot of passion around the space.
Yeah.
And once you get excited about something, you have to get smart on it really quickly. If you want to make your limited partners money. I mean, that's the business that we're in. So I think it's getting smart. And if you don't have that expertise, you got to surround yourself with it. But I think the motivation to get, if you can get excited about something, and it almost goes back to your last question about the entrepreneur, you know, how do they raise capital for their big moonshot idea? Well, you know, it's mostly PowerPoint in the early days.
Yeah.
It's all PowerPoint. There's no Excel. And so they've got to tell a really compelling story. And they have to tell it to people who are curious about that story. So if you're curious about autonomous vehicles, well, you know, hopefully you're going to get a good match and you're both going to dive deep and learn.
We've organized ourselves purposely to not have people specializing because when people are specialized, now it's a little easier to do at the later stage than the earlier stage, but when people are specialized, they tend to look for things in their little silo. And the big thing might be in a completely different side. So we want all our people to be generalists looking across the map. But then once we do a deal in a particular area, then the particular people who happen to have done that one would tend to do others in that area. But as we first get into something, we really keep it as an open playing field. And I think that but it's a balance. We also, I've led all of our investments in like gaming and alternative lending, two areas that I mentioned before. And there's some expertise that does develop from that. But at the same time, we're all free agents looking at new things. And if it's autonomy or whatever, we're not hidebound to look at, you know, hey, I do all the SaaS software in the firm kind of thing.
Right. And how as a partnership do you think about decision making? Different partnerships have different models around this. Some are very consensus-driven, where others are more individual partner-driven?
Ours is consensus-driven, but nobody has a veto. Some of the best ideas are controversial. Somebody may not like it. But we're looking for a broad consensus, and we believe every deal is a firm deal. We put two partners on every deal when we're doing it. Mm-hmm. We don't do any investments where all of the partners haven't met the team, you know, so we make a collective decision, and we have a culture that says we don't second guess those investments. So when I make an investment that doesn't work, and I guess we all do, the person that's concerned about that and is banging their head against the wall is only me. Mm-hmm. My partners say we all made the decision together. They also say if something really doesn't work out and, like, you know, the thing closes down or something, we have very little of that, but as a late stage. But they say, okay, great, you get your time back. What a constructive attitude that is. You know, I'm still banging my head against the wall internally, I can tell you. But the that kind of culture, I think, helps collegiality. So it's, you know, we try not to have a star system and the make it a collegial investment. That works for us. Other models work for other firms, though.
Yeah, there's a lot of models that work. You know, I think the, you know, we're pretty similar to how Sandy outlined it. But it's, you know, when you have the investment come in, everyone says, that's great, let's definitely, and everybody wants to do it, you should run for the hills. I mean, because almost every, you know, and it goes back to something Gary said about passion, because you're going to spend time with an entrepreneur, maybe two folks on your team, a lot of time. You know, maybe they come in and meet all the partners. But I mean, I would say if someone's really, if you get that passionate about something and you've done the work, then let's go all in. But you know, most of the, you know, I'm thinking over the last decade, most of the deals that have been really successful, you know, we were the first investor in Vistaprint. You know, it was free business cards, you know, for the very small business under 20 employees, and it was for us a big check. It was, you know, very controversial, you know, but what they had figured out a way is to batch small job sizes so they could have very good margins. But it wasn't intuitive at that time that would be a really good business, because it wasn't a sector that you'd say, you know, we're looking at the printing space. But so, you know, I think, you know, most of the really great investments, by definition, there's going to be some controversy. I think when we look back and we say, where did we go wrong? Because we all, you know, go wrong. And in early stage, you're going to have some, you know, ones that just don't, is where we thought just about the market, and some firms just bet the market. For us, is getting that team right, the early team DNA, what's special about the team. And I reflect to my, going back to my first Greylock pitch, I remember I had all, this is when you still had PowerPoint, you know. I remember being at Kinko's all night on a Sunday night to go to do the partner pitch at Greylock. I was very nervous. You know, handed out, Greylock had breakfast, and I got the breakfast. I'm like, this is so nice. I handed out all the PowerPoints. The room was packed. And Dave Strom said, Peter, can you start in high school and take us through today? Mm-hmm. And then we never got to the, like, you know, and that was a good lesson for me. You know, just thinking about the team and the people, particularly in the early stages, where it's going to be a journey and you're going to have some type of pivots over the years. So getting that right is often, for, you know, my experience on both as an entrepreneur and as an investor is the most important thing.
Yeah. And, you know, speaking of that, what would each of you say is the number one indicator of success in a company?
It's that, a lot of it's the people.
I think the CEO is still, I mean, we say you back teams, but at the end of the day, the CEO is really driving the company, and you know, backing the right CEOs has been the key. If there's a key, common denominator, I think that's it.
Yeah, to me, the CEO and the team that he or she's building, and then if you look, you know, luck plays a role.
Yeah.
You know, if you look at the, you know, why one company fails that has a good team, has a good product. You know, I spent 10 years at EMC, and you know, we had some good fortune that essentially our competitors, way back when IBM storage tech, essentially stumbled for 2 years on how they're going to get this next gen product out, and they couldn't get it out, and we had some good luck that they sort of didn't execute well, and that. You know, and then during that period of time, you know, the company took off. So there's some luck plays a role. It's hard to put that, you know, in dollars and cents, and hard to have that as a part of your investment decision making. But there, you know, if you look at, you know, most great companies, something happened along the way and that's how life is too. You know, so I think luck plays a role, but I think getting the CEO right. And that's only the only lever as an investor, you know, to me, that's the bet. You know, it's sort of like I'm a bad golfer, but I win a lot of golf bets because you know, once the bet's made on the CEO, it's particularly if you're doing early stage, it's really hard to switch.
Yeah.
Not impossible, but pretty difficult.
And what are some of the characteristics you're looking for in a founder CEO?
passion, certainly, about the sense, and this is why, obviously, the Greylock partners were grilling you from high school on, the how somebody you're guessing will react through tough times, see a new way to move, pivot the company, or just overcome major hurdles. Somebody who's got the fortitude to do that, and leadership skills to lead a team that's no doubt going to get much larger than the team is at the moment. So you have to say somebody good leader now, and will they be a good leader 5 years from now? But it's hard to, it's very subjective.
We look also for high integrity, and that's not only that they're trustworthy, but the type of people that are going to do what they say they're going to do. Mm-hmm. We look for smart, and there's lots of different smart. Doesn't mean they went to Harvard, but they're they could be street smart or strong enough to get it done. The one thing for me is what I've learned from being a CEO is, there's good hill figure outers and there's good hill takers. And hill figure outer isn't a word, but hopefully you know what I mean. So there's people that are really good at figuring out what hill to take, and then there are people who are really good at taking the hill. And I think a good CEO has the right balance between the two. And they can't be, if it's a scale, if it's a continuum, you can't say that one is hill figure outer and 10 is hill taker. They can't be a five. They've got to be strong in one or the other, but they have to have know enough that they're not the best hill taker to surround themselves with hill takers. So I think there's an element there, but we tend to look for good hill figure outers, right? It's that good strategic gene. And then there's this sort of a competitive gene as well. It's like you just get this feeling that, I don't even know if I completely agree with the business. I do believe there's a big market here, but this is the guy that's gonna figure it out. This is the person. I trust that they'll sort it out no matter what the path is through that. And so you try and identify all of those things in one package. One of my bosses used to say, you can teach a chicken to climb a tree, but you're better off getting a squirrel in the first place. And it's good it's good if you know what a squirrel looks like. You know what I mean? So we try and look for those squirrels.
Yeah, and I think, I like the analogy, both analogies. true. But also, particularly here in the Valley, but in any hotbed of innovation, garnering talent is so difficult. So particularly in the early stages, where you don't have maybe the revenue, you don't have a big balance sheet yet, is someone who's going to be a talent magnet for whatever reason, and even in sometimes younger entrepreneurs. You can sort of see signs that somehow, we backed a very young a guy who was just beginning his sophomore year at Princeton, and he was smart and had a lot of the characteristics.
Is that the 14-year-old?
No, that was Seth when he was 19.
That was
Seth from Level Up. But when I met him, everyone I called at Princeton, both faculty members, folks who lived, we called folks who lived on his in his dorm, he was just sort of this leader. And sort of the bet was that he would be able to recruit a team, particularly an engineering team in the early years to sort of, begin to execute on the product roadmap. So, someone who can really garner talent, because you when you call CEOs, you say, what are you, everyone's focused on team building, no matter what stage they're at. And, that's an important skill, but some of it's learned, but some of it is sort of who that person is and some things they may have done early in their life that give indication that they'll be strong at building, building and recruiting great teams.
I think you said something else really important, which is you can interview a company, you can meet with the company, you can meet with that CEO a dozen times, and you get a feeling that they have this characteristic, but the background check is incredibly important. And it's not only important for investing, it's important for all of you building your companies to do that as well. Past performance is a great indicator of what's going to happen in the future. So it's not a bad idea to call a couple of off the balance sheet references and say, how smart is this guy? How creative is this guy? How trustworthy is this person? So I think that's a key criteria of investing and building companies.
Great. Let's shift gears a little bit and talk about some of the areas each of you is individually passionate about. So Gary, starting with you, You've written extensively about the idea of the freelance economy, and I think a lot of, in the media, there's been a lot of discussion around the movement to a 1099 work structure. What do you see as some of the biggest societal issues that shift is presenting, and what are some of the biggest opportunities as well?
Well, I think there's a massive opportunity here. You know, the future of work is, the world is changing. The talent is the single biggest lever that we all have in our businesses, and you know, we're just talking about how hard it is to hire. You know, 60% of business leaders say they can't achieve their goals because they don't have the talent they need when they need it. So something's got to change there. So on the demand side, you've got this need for change, and then on the supply side, you know, majority of the workforce will be millennial by 2025. Mm-hmm. So the world is changing. The workers of today look very differently. I was at the Aspen Institute, and one of the professors from MIT had a great quote. He said that his dad had one job his whole career. He'll have seven jobs in his career, and his kid will have seven jobs at one time. So there's there's this shift. The world's moving more on demand. There's more globalization, and I don't mean that we're sending work offshore. I mean companies are going global much earlier in their life cycle. You know, like Odesk was global in year two. We didn't plan to go global; it just happened. You know, and so it's becoming more global. It's becoming more flexible, more on demand, more transparent. And so companies are struggling to acquire talent. They're struggling to keep good talent. You know, especially the learners of today will have 10 jobs by the time they're 40. That's a new job every 2 years. So companies have to get smarter about not only attracting good talent and getting them ramped up quickly, but then retaining them mm-hmm. and keeping them engaged. And so I think it's there's just tremendous opportunities in all these areas. You know, to help companies hire good talent, help ramp good talent, help retain good talent, and help that talent to grow and or not, or to leave and go somewhere else and be successful somewhere else. And so technology can be applied to all of those spaces. And there's obviously lots of tailwinds behind the business, behind this category as well.
You know, and it's interesting, as I could agree with that completely, and as those kind of workers deal with issues that emerge from being in the gig economy. One of them is the healthcare aspect, because you no longer have your employer healthcare plan. A company on the board of care.com announced that they've got a program now to where people can contribute to their healthcare plan from the various, all that they happen to provide. They're the largest nanny provider in the world. From each of their assignments, they can contribute into a healthcare plan that's portable for them. And I think it's a model that'll be used more in the future. But I mention it because we'll need things like that to make this kind of economy work. And it also creates some new interesting and new businesses and investment opportunities as we serve those new millennial workers in the gig economy.
Yeah, I was thinking about Gary's analogy with seven jobs at one time. We have a company that Gary helped us out with. It was called Hourly Nerd. Yep. We recently changed the name to Catalan, but it's business expertise, you know, on demand. And the company's doing great, but it's, you know, everyone from someone who might be moonlighting, you know, but they have an expertise in a certain field, or people are building their businesses, you know, where they're doing, you know, five, six, seven jobs at one time, or perhaps they're a stay-at-home mom. They had, you know, they were in the workforce, had children, but still have a lot of expertise, but can work when their kids are, you know, at school or napping or whatever it might be. And it's really using technology to build a platform around business expertise. So it really hopefully plays into kind of the tailwinds, on the millennials and how they want to, you know, kind of have that work-life balance.
Yeah, they value that freedom and that flexibility even more than income right now, right? And the companies love it as well because they don't need a full-time worker. So you'll see more. I think a lot more vertical applications of this, but then also platforms to support who's going to handle my taxes. Am I 1099 or W-2? What about the companies figuring out who's 1099 or W-2 and then somebody managing that for them? All of these are going to be business opportunities going forward, the insurance.
Gary, another topic you've written about is the end of ownership and this idea that, you know, millennials are deferring purchases of homes, purchases of automobiles, and are instead, you know, preferring to do things like rent their apartment or home, use kind of recurring services instead of buying things. Mm-hmm. You know, how do you see that unfolding, and what are some of What are some of the opportunities for that founders can still tackle that, you know, take advantage of that trend?
Well, I think this is a massive opportunity. Millennials don't want to own. There's lots of societies. We were talking about this in Korea. There's not enough natural resources. There's not enough land. There's not enough opportunity in the city. So they're getting really great at this whole sharing economy. So maybe I sleep in my apartment, but you need a place to work. I go to work. Well, why not use my apartment for your office while I'm at work? And so this sharing of space and sharing of cars, and I just think there's, you know, it's looking at where are the big areas that we're spending and consuming, and therein lie the opportunities, and especially ones with high regulation. You know, you think about Odesk was about work and moving money, and there's a lot of regulatory concerns there. Airbnb and apartments, right? I mean, a lot of regulatory. Uber and taxi, a lot of regulatory. Where you tackle these legacy systems that haven't been touched in 50 years, therein lies the opportunity. And the harder it is, I think, the bigger the moat you can build around the business. So I don't know where the next ones are. If anybody here does, I'm interested to hear about it, but I'm not smart enough to figure. I'm more the hill taker than the hill figure outer. You come tell me and I'll help you take the hill. That's the way I look at it.
You mentioned regulated businesses. Historically, firms like ours avoided them like the plague. And I think in recent years now, if you get in the right ones, if you've conquered the regulatory hurdles, then you've got that's a barrier to entry for others. So we're no longer scared away by regulation the way we had been a decade ago.
I do think, actually, I missed one that's glaring. You know, I mentioned Polaris is both healthcare and technology, and the intersection of healthcare and technology is really interesting for us because we have healthcare experience and tech experience and go-to-market. So that the intersection of healthcare and IT, I think there's a lot of disruption ahead in the healthcare, and as it relates to not necessarily drugs and platforms, but in healthcare IT.
Sandy, you've invested in a number of lending companies. You mentioned some of them earlier, SoFi, Prosper, and OnDeck, to name a few. You know, it's been a tough year for the lending tech sector with everything that unfolded at Lending Club earlier this year. Do you think in lending and financial technology more broadly, do you think we're kind of done for now, or do you think that there's still a wave of innovation to come in those areas?
Oh, I think we're in early innings. I mean, one of the things, you talked about what makes successful companies, and we all agree the CEO and team is first. But another one is pick good competitors, that is weak competitors. And the beauty of financial technology is you're competing against giant competitors, but the big banks, for example, are dealing with, they've all been built by acquisition, so they've got mismatched legacy technology systems. So it's easy to have a technology advantage over somebody who's spending many billions a year on technology. You can still have an advantage. They're highly regulated, subject to enormous litigation from the past, really hidebound organizations. You know, you must feel sorry for them. But the so they're the right kind of competitor. So I think we're still ripe for innovation, not just in alternative lending, but in all parts of financial technology. I think we're in the early innings of it. I think take somebody like SoFi has looked at it a different way. They started in lending, but they're with student loans, but they're really focused on a particular demographic, people who make a fair amount of, they call them the Henrys, the high earning, not yet rich people. It's a pretty big group. People who went mainly to fine universities all around the country, but they're really distrustful of banks, and maybe for good reason. And so they're providing a full suite of financial services for that demographic, I think, is a huge opportunity, and that company is just in the early innings of it. But there's so many other segments of what is, in some ways, the largest market in the world, financial markets, and as I mentioned, all digital, so it's easy to address with technology. So I think we're early stage in that.
I like the new commercials you're running at SoFi. You're good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're good. Are there particular areas of financial services where you see the most opportunity?
Well, I think the payments area is still is still ripe for disruption. The amount that the credit card companies take of a transaction seems incredible that they still can get away with that. I mean, these are large transactions, and they're taking, you know, several hundred basis points in some cases in transactions. So I think we're seeing it there. Transfer payments across geographies is another one where there's very, very high margins. These are really lucrative businesses, and they're not that user friendly. So I think there's a lot of areas in finance. So you look for where the money is, mm-hmm. and where there's big margins, this should be big opportunity.
And Peter, payments is another area where you've spent some time. You're an investor in WePay. What do you see as the opportunities in that space?
Well, I think the interchange is one that's obviously to Sandy's point, and I think just sort of with all these new marketplace businesses, mm-hmm. you know, from crowdfunding to some of the kind of next generation business tools, there's a whole new opportunity in terms of the payment process. Risk, you're able to leverage the social graph to reduce the risk of fraud. There's a lot of new ways that are much more effective. We're founding at WePay that, our competitors, which are really the old payment processors for some of the same reasons that Sandy pointed out in the banks, are good people to compete with. And the same thing's happening, kind of the mobile device. And I think, obviously everyone sitting in this room either has some, obviously an iPhone or an Android device. But, I think what you're going to see with the new iPhone, with a new watch, I think really, mobile payments is a tremendous opportunity. And that's one where there is currently Apple is working with the banks, but I think there's going to be a significant opportunity there to focus on the consumer experience, much more valuable data for the merchant. That's one of the opportunities that we're seeing at Level Up, one of my other mobile payments companies, is really providing a merchant data, a much more robust set of tools and analytics for them to make decisions on kind of what the products they're carrying, when to they're pinging their customers in terms of how they communicate. So I think there's a whole new opportunities happening that's really driven by the mobile device.
Sandy, you are an investor in several highly successful gaming startups, Zynga, Supercell, and Gmoco, to name a few. Gaming, historically has been somewhat of a hit-driven business. How do you think about identifying the companies there that are really going to stand out?
Yeah, it is a challenge because it's a hits-driven business. Sometimes you just see a team and you think these guys can really, really do it. I mean, when we first invested in Supercell, company was exclusively in Helsinki then, small company, already had a hit. Mm-hmm. The issue is whether they'd have more, more hits. But the productivity that they had was so astonishing. That's hence the name Supercell. Their cell was a small cadre of people sitting in one room together developing a product. And that's the way it was in the early days at Zynga as well. When they're still back at the chip factory on Vermont Street, and the small teams developing, in that case, Zynga Poker, Farmville, the things that became, billion-dollar businesses. But with the productivity of the Supercell team was really unprecedented, though, and and we felt that they could really replicate that success, and they've had. They've had had new hits that emerged over time. And I think they kept it lean and small, and they people that really had superior game development capabilities and a good marketing instinct.
And how do you see we talked a little bit about virtual reality, augmented reality, and kind of how and when that's going to start to impact things like the gaming world. And Peter, you can chime in here as well from your involvement in Leap Motion.
Yeah, I think it's just, people are looking for an ever richer experience, so they're just not going to be satisfied with the current game experience. What people did 5 years ago would seem people wouldn't want to do now, and they're going to want to be doing something 5 years from now different than today. It's really hard to predict, kind of when it happens, and even which company is going to be the winner in it. But this one looks inevitable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. I mean, that price point's got to come down on the headset. It's very expensive still to, you know, kind of put together everything. And if you've ever had a, you know, a headset on for more than 10 minutes, I mean, some people can get, you know, a little woozy. So there's certain things that have to be, you know, kind of calibrated there. But it doesn't, it really feels like this is just going to be, you know, massive. I just see, I have three teenagers. I see just the way, you know, everything from, you know, gaming and sort of, you know, these multiplayer. I'm not a gamer, but, you know, the TV, so they don't watch live TV anymore other than perhaps, they don't even watch live sports. I mean, they just watch, you know, the highlights on ESPN, then it's back, you know, back to gaming.
Or watch people playing
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Electronic.
Yes, they do that. They will do that, which is kind of, you're watching another person play a game. It's just unbelievable.
And so maybe this is a good example of, you know, an area where even though you see it as a few years out, this is one where the opportunity is so clear that it makes sense.
The challenge is not every, the space will be a huge winner, but there's going to be so much carnage. And, you know, Sandy's coming in later where some, you know, we, you know, going back to my boring store, I mean, storage mm-hmm. was one of the best places to invest for 20 years. But there was only a few mega winners. There's tons of companies. Mm-hmm. You know, at one point at EMC, we counted 80, looked like direct competitors and went out of business. All the same market, selling to the same customers. So it's still going back to the CEO and the team. Mm-hmm. And you know, picking the right ones is still going to be a challenge.
It does, you know, it suggests that you'd want to have a series of, portfolio of potential companies, but it's even hard to pick which, you know, certainly you're not going to make money investing in them all, that's clear. Mm-hmm. And they're pretty capital intensive, actually. That's another challenge. So it's hard. In some areas that look, you know the thing is going to work, but you don't know which company. At an early stage investor, you can place a whole series of smaller investments. This one, the problem is it's hard to make small investments because the companies are capital intensive. So.
It does, to me, I'm just an outsider. We just say no, right? Mm-hmm. But it feels like we're not even in the first inning. I mean, it just feels so early to me, but it's happening, right?
Yeah.
And Peter, you mentioned your experience at Storage Networks. On the enterprise side, can you still make investments in infrastructure when, you know, so many people see everything moving to the cloud?
Yeah. Well, I was at a conference yesterday, and one of the speakers was Diane Green, who's a terrific entrepreneur. She was the founder of VMware. Now she's running the enterprise cloud for Google. And she said, you know, this is the biggest thing ever to happen to IT, which is coming from her. That's an important statement and probably a very accurate one. But the answer is, yeah, there's unbelievable opportunities. I mean, yes, it's all moving to the cloud, and you're going to need a whole new set of tools from, you know, look at companies like Okta, which is on my anti-portfolio because I met those guys when Todd was leaving Salesforce and Freddie was at MIT, you know, going early, you know, raising a couple $1 million to get started, but sort of the whole security paradigm changing is just one example. The whole kind of database infrastructure. I mean, there's so, is Amazon gonna be a dominant player? Is Google gonna be a dominant player? Absolutely. But there's a whole new set of software services that'll be wrapped into the cloud. So I think it's, you know, it's not quite as exciting as some of these places, you know, gaming or autonomous vehicles or next-gen workforce, but in the enterprise, and it's not just sort of the startups that are embracing the cloud. I mean, it's really life insurance companies, it's financial services, it's manufacturing. You know, they are moving to the cloud and they're beginning to move into production. So we've got some investments that are riding, you know, kind of on top of those, you know, kind of that macro shift. And, you know, I think it's one of the most exciting areas, you know, and probably about a third of our portfolio is around kind of enterprise cloud, you know, software and purpose-built infrastructure.
And it's still pretty, I mean, if you look across the broad swath of large enterprises, they're all know they're going to embrace the cloud, but the percentage movement into the cloud so far is still pretty early. And you think about the trillions of dollars, really, that of replacement technology that makes it a huge market. We've made many investments in it as well.
Actually, one of my first investments was a company called Clicker, and they were helping companies with their hybrid cloud. So old companies that clearly weren't going to go all in the cloud, but now you got the complexity of managing on-prem and cloud, and how do you move assets between, and when do you move, and what about compliance and cost and timing and the like. And so they built software to streamline the moving of those. And you know, 3 months after we made the investment, every major player came knocking, saying, we care about hybrid cloud. So they had good fortune to sell to Cisco 11 months after we invested. So I think there's still a massive opportunity.
But I think one of the biggest shifts there that we see is that while the technology's changing, also this kind of go-to-market, like the model I grew up in my early years at EMC, where you had this sort of big enterprise sales force in every NFL city, you know, that model's gone. You know, so figuring out not only what products to build, but how are you going to get those to market? You know, Gary talked about inside sales. A lot of my companies use inside sales. They're using the technology to have a much more cost-effective, go-to-market. And that's the thing we look for in the entrepreneurs, is not just what tech are you going to build, but in the enterprise is, you know, what's going to be the sales model? Because you have to go compete and, you know, with Oracle or something that has distribution in place, you're going to get your clock cleaned.
Yeah, that's a huge point. And, you know, the lesson for me was I'm a same, you know, I was rational software, wasn't as hardcore as EMC, but a, you know, huge enterprise sales force. And my first inclination at Odesk was to build a sales force, and we ended up shuttering the sales force and going to pure marketing because it wasn't going to scale. There was no way we were going to be able to get, you know, we ended up getting 4 million clients with no sales force. And so that was an innovation on the go-to-market. We had to make it transactional instead of enterprise. And you see a ton of that now with, you know, Slack and GitHub and Atlassian. There's no sales force at Atlassian. There might be now, but there wasn't for 10 years, right? And so the innovation of how you're going to get this product to market. There's been plenty of companies I've looked at where I said, I love the technology, I love the team. It's going to be too hard to scale, right? They're not thinking about how are you going to get this thing to market at scale.
Great. Well, I think that brings us to the end of our time. So thank you all for joining us here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks.